Welcome to The Hair Loss Show. Dr. Russell Knudsen and Dr. Vikram Jayaprakash discuss issues relating to hair loss and the medical and surgical treatment of hair loss in both men and women.
Hi everyone, welcome to podcast number 3 of The Hair Loss Show. I'm Dr. Russell Knudsen.
And I'm Dr. Vikram Jayaprakash. Russell, good to see you again.
Thank you. So last podcast, we talked about the principal causes of male pattern baldness. So today we're going to start to walk you through therapy for male pattern baldness and talk about the things that we know as medical professionals that have an effect upon the hair in patients with male pattern balding. So the first thing I need to bring to your attention today is that many patients come in and say they've tried different therapies and they didn't work. And I say to them, well, what do you mean by it didn't work? And they say, well, my hair didn't grow back. I said, okay, but whilst you're on the therapy, were you getting worse? And they'd say, no, but it didn't grow back. And I said, and what happened when you stopped the therapy? And they say, well, it got worse. So the first point I would like to emphasize to you is that preventing deterioration of a progressive condition is our definition of the first level of success. So success is stability. Stability means not losing more hair. That's not shedding. Remember, shedding and hair loss are two different things. If you're getting thinner, that's not success. If you're not getting thinner, then that is, in male pattern baldness, the first level of success. The greater level of success, of course, is improvement, which is what we want to try and achieve if we can. But that really depends upon, as Dr. Vikram said in an earlier podcast, how quickly you come into therapy. So the summary of it is that realistically, we are better at stabilizing people. We have greater success at preventing further hair loss than we do at regrowing hair. It is possible in some people, but not in everyone.
Absolutely. So the key there is that we have to understand that male pattern hair loss is a progressive condition. If you've got male pattern hair loss, there's a good chance in 12 months' time you're going to be worse than where you are if we don't initiate any therapy. So success in that respect, first and foremost, is trying to halt the progress of the condition. You know, if we can stop things getting any worse, and you always talk about leaking bucket syndrome, isn't it? So we talk about if you've got a bucket of water and the amount of water in this analogy is the amount of hair that you have on your head. Male pattern hair loss is a little hole at the bottom of the bucket where you're leaking water. The first part is not to try and pour warm water in, it's to try and actually fix that leak to stop this from getting any worse.
When I started treating hair loss in the early 1980s, as I said before, there was nothing. So realistically, there was no way to stop that leak. And so all we could do at that stage was top up the bucket, and that required surgery. But luckily, beginning in 1989 with the first product that came into Australia, which was minoxidil, and in 1998 with the second product that came into Australia, which is finasteride, it changed much for the better. So what we're going to do today is talk about the use of finasteride, a blocker that is designed to be effective in reducing the activity of the enzyme.
So if you remember from our last episode number two, so if you haven't had a chance, it's probably worthwhile going back to episode number two to get some of the basics, reacquaint yourself with the basics. Male pattern hair loss, you need the gene for it, but the essential principle is you've got testosterone is being converted into another form of that testosterone, dihydrotestosterone, by the enzyme 5-alpha reductase. Too much of this, because you've got too much activity of this, too much of this will cause your hair to thin out and fall out if you've got the gene for hair loss.
So the targeted therapy, modern targeted therapy for male pattern baldness, is to block some of the enzyme activity. And this is where the medicine finasteride comes into play. So we call it a blocker because it doesn't block hormones, it blocks the enzyme. So if we have a look at what that actually means, if you put the testosterone going across here to DHT again,
so
doctor.
Testosterone to DHT.
Okay, so you've got the 5-alpha reductase here. So let's cross that out. We've blocked some of that. So what happens then is that the DHT level goes down.
Not as much of this is going into that, and therefore that is going to go down.
So what happens to the testosterone?
Well, if that's not being converted to that, there's a mild increase in the testosterone.
So people, we're not blocking hormones, we're blocking the enzyme. As your DHT goes down, your T level goes up. So if you're using finasteride, which we're going to talk about now, the DHT level is down by about 2/3, but the testosterone level goes up by just over 10%. So we're not blocking hormones. We're not reducing the amount of male hormones in your body. We're just changing the ratio between the testosterone and the DHT. And that's a critical point because people describe finasteride as a DHT blocker. And I know it sounds like semantics, but it's not a DHT blocker. It is a 5-alpha reductase blocker. And it blocks 2/3 of the enzyme activity, which lowers the DHT. Now, the outcome for that is that it's then, if you can get the DHT down to the non-harmful level, you can achieve stability.
That's clear.
So what were the figures for finasteride in the trials that were done?
So we know that, when we've studied this, and we know that men taking finasteride at a particular dose, 1 milligram, dose 3 times a week, at 1 year, 86% of men showed no progression of their hair loss, meaning that they were stable at the end of 1 year.
No worse.
No worse. At 2 years, that dropped down to 82%. So there was a slight drop, okay, but still, 82% of guys were still stable at 2 years. And at 5 years, there was a little bit more of an appreciable drop, but the figures are 67%, which means that if you're a male and you take your finasteride for 5 years, you've got a better than 2 out of 3 chance of keeping your hair the way it is right now. So the question then becomes, well, you know, there's a 33%, you know, that are not responsive. But are they less responsive? That's the key.
They're less responsive. So remember, if you take the DHT level down by, say, 2/3, in some people that's enough to stabilize them. In others, it doesn't completely stabilize them. So to go back to the leak analogy, we haven't completely fixed the leak, but we've certainly slowed it down.
So meaning that that 33%, who had taken the medication are probably going to be better off than if they hadn't taken the medication.
And that is a take-home message for people here too, that we're not curing it, we're treating it. So that means that for you to maintain a benefit, you have to continue to take the medication. You can't just treat it like a course of antibiotics where you take it for 1 or 2 weeks.
That's right.
And problem is solved. If you're going to fight your genes, which is what you're doing, and fighting your 5-alpha reductase enzyme, which is what you're doing, you have to keep taking your medication.
So how long am I going to be taking my medication for?
Well, the short answer is, when people ask me that, my response is, as long as you care. Mm-hmm. So in other words, if you said at 20 or 25, I cared about losing hair, but I'm now 40, I'm married, I've got kids, I really don't care anymore, don't take the meds. Let nature take its course. So it's not compulsory for you to take it for the rest of your life, unless you don't want to lose any hair through balding for the rest of your life. And the figures at 10 years are probably going to be a little bit less than even at 5 years. So again, it's important to understand we don't have 100% control of these things. But it is fair to say that for people in our practice who are milder with their balding, we have evidence over 20 years that they have not progressed their hair loss. So in some people, you can get stability for 20 years. Not everybody, but in some people.
That's right.
So this is a targeted therapy, right? It's targeted for male pattern baldness. So no, you don't use it for people that are losing hair because they've got thyroid disorders or they've got iron deficiency. This is a specific therapy targeted at male pattern baldness. And it revolutionized the treatment of male pattern baldness when it came into the marketplace. It made an absolute massive difference to the management of hair loss, because until then, men had been somewhat distressed by the fact that they maybe could slow it down a little bit, but they had no control over it. And that's a very disempowering state of mind to be in. Once we were able to offer them something that was target specific and effective, and by the way, it has no impact upon the liver, the lungs, the brain, the heart. It's a very, very safe medicine. And even more as important as that is that it doesn't interact with other medications. So realistically, you can be on any medication for another condition of whatever sort, and finasteride does not interfere with other therapies. It's safe, it's effective, it's been the single most important advance in the management of hair loss, of male pattern baldness, in the 35 years that I've been treating it.
So let's talk about a few things. I mean, we covered a few myths before. So these are a couple of questions that I keep getting asked during, when I see patients. And this is in no particular order. One of the things, we're dropping DHT. We must be pushing up testosterone. That's a great thing, isn't it? But should I take finasteride to really boost my testosterone? I generally say to people, no, you're not going to get you get a little bit of an increase in your testosterone, you're not going to get a massive increase.
It's not enough.
No. And the reason is that, yes, that doesn't get converted into that, but there are the metabolic pathways that gets broken down into other things. So there is a little bit of an increase in testosterone, but you wouldn't go, hey, I need to boost my testosterone level, let me take finasteride to do it. It's not going to work. No. Right?
So the next thing I think we really want to issue with you and describe to you is the mythology around the safety and side effect profile of finasteride.
Because we get a lot of pushback on finasteride.
The information on the internet is highly emotive and highly difficult to understand. It's safe. Very few of our patients get any side effects because we know what the chemistry of the drug is in the body, and we make sure that you're only taking just the right amount that's going to do the job, not too much that would increase the risk of side effects. Now, this is a very complex issue that's going to take its own podcast. So we're going to spend time on our next podcast walking you through the pros and cons of finasteride, walking you through the myth and the reality of what the side effects and what the problems are with it. I hope you found this informative. I hope you're enjoying the podcast series. Thanks for listening again today, and good night from me.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. So just to recap, just a quick 30-second recap. Testosterone gets converted into dihydrotestosterone. We want to lower that in the system, and we do that by blocking the 5-alpha reductase enzyme. We have a drug called finasteride that can do that, and the goal of that finasteride is to try and stabilize this hair loss. So if we can stop the progression of this hair loss, that is an absolute victory for us. Again, this needs to be, this is not something that you buy over the counter. Please don't buy it on the internet or anything like that. This is something that you need to see your doctor about. You need to get a prescription. You need to, have someone who's medically trained to guide you through this process, to talk you through the pros, the cons, all of that. But hopefully this gives you enough information for which to start making an informed decision. So that's it for today.
That's it for today.
Thanks very much, and we'll see you at episode number 4. See you next time.
Bye.